Good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody here this morning. A couple people asked me how I love this weather, and I thought, well, this is summer weather in New York. This is great. I just love it. We often don't stop wearing long sleeves up there, and that's the way I like it. Angie's not here this morning. Now, all I'm saying, it was the early hours of the day, and she wasn't feeling that great. But I'm not saying it's morning sickness. It's just a sickness in the morning. That's how we'll put it. No, I think she's got whatever seasonal something's happening. She did test for COVID yesterday. It wasn't that. That maybe some food disagreements. She's still struggling through there. But anyway, we're hoping to have her back on her feet here pretty soon. I asked Jim Taylor if he would go ahead and lead us in a prayer before our class here this morning.
Dear God, our Father in heaven, we're so thankful for this day. We're thankful for all the Christians that are gathering here this morning to hear another lesson from your word. We pray that you'll be with Doug. Continue to give him the wisdom and continue to be with him as he helps lead our congregation here in learning more from you. We pray for all those that are on the sick list. We pray that you would give them comfort and care. Be with us as we go through our class this morning. Thank you for Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
We were also without power this morning. It was after my shower, which was good. So that didn't happen in the middle of that, but the power went out, so I'll have to call after service and see if the power is restored and if she needs anything. Here we are. We are in the last month of this study of the root of Jesse. We began in May with talking about the kinsman redeemer, and we went through the story of Ruth and how it is that Jesus fulfills the kinsman redeemer for us as one who is able to redeem us from the life that we are a life of sin that we are in, and how we are separated from God and redeeming us back to God. We went from there to talking about Saul, and Saul was one of those characters that he started out well and then he did not finish well. And we could see with Saul that he was so humble at the very beginning that when they called him to be king and to anoint him as king, that he was hiding amongst the baggage, but by the end he had erected a statue in his own honor. And he had offered sacrifices as only the priests could do, and he had taken responsibilities on that were never his. He was not waiting for God. He was doing things his way. We went from there to this past month where we've been talking about David. And we had already done the life of David in our studies before last summer. And so we weren't really looking to look at the details of David's life, but we were looking to look at the fulfillment of the promise to David that he would always have a man to sit upon his throne, that his throne would be established forever. And so we looked at the King of Kings in particular after having looked at Samuel as well. And so the path of Samuel is crossed into both Saul and David life, and now we're taking a different turn. Samuel's long dead, and we're looking at the very beginning of Solomon's reign. Again, Solomon is one of those figures where he starts out very, very well, and that's what we'll be looking at in the next few weeks, and how it was that Solomon started out well in seeking wisdom from God, walking in the ways of his father David. We're not going to cover the last part of Solomon's reign right now, where Solomon began to turn away from God and follow idols with his 700 wives and 300 concubines. Instead, we're going to focus in on the good things here to see how it is that Jesus fulfills, again, the root of Jesse, the promise that would be handed down and fulfilled in David's descendant, Jesus, and how that came about. And so we're looking at wisdom. So we start with that promise that David gave, was given to David, I should say, in 2 Samuel chapter 7. And this was the basis for our study last month as we looked at the King of Kings and how it was that Jesus fulfilled that from this promise. But it says here in 2 Samuel 7, when your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your brothers, I will raise up your offspring after you who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He, Solomon, shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. So that is going to be one of our studies, in that it was not David who was able to build the temple for God. David had it in his heart to build a house for God, and God said it was good that you had that in your heart, but you're a man of war, a man of blood. I'm going to allow your son to build that. And David, in the last part of his life, gets around all the materials for the temple and draws up the plans for the temple and gives them all to his son Solomon, and then passes away. So Solomon shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Doesn't say that Solomon's going to live forever. It says that the throne of his kingdom will be established forever. So unlike Saul, and who turned away from God, and God took away his kingship, we're going to see with Solomon, David and Solomon, all the way down to Jesus, that the throne is established forever, because Jesus sits upon that throne forever. I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. When he commits iniquity, I will discipline him with the rod of men and with the stripes of the sons of men. And indeed, when Solomon turned away from God, we see God raising up enemies, various nations around, various figures like Jeroboam, who was in charge of Solomon's forced labor, that Jeroboam will rise up and end up taking the 10 northern tribes and creating the northern kingdom. And Rehoboam, Solomon's son, will have the southern kingdom there. But it's also fulfilled in the King of Kings, as we see that in Isaiah 53, we're talking about Jesus here, some 700 some odd years before Jesus walked in the flesh, that we see that he would, by his stripes, we are healed. And so, in some ways, Jesus does fulfill that part of it as well, as he was able to fulfill, being that root of Jesse, taking on the sin of mankind. By his stripes we are healed, even though he had committed no sin himself. But my steadfast love will not depart from him, as I took it from Saul, and your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. And obviously that can only be fulfilled in Jesus, who is the King of Kings. So today we're going to be looking in and focusing in on the very beginning of Solomon's reign, and how it was that when God came to him and said, "Ask me for anything and I will give it to you," that Solomon asked for wisdom, a discerning heart, to be able to rule the kingdom that God had given to him from his father David. And so just being able to ask for wisdom shows that Solomon had a little bit of wisdom to start with, but we're going to see that his wisdom that comes only from God is different than the wisdom of man, and that it is the kind of wisdom that the world really cannot understand. And he's going to be described as having more wisdom than any of the kings that would ever follow him ever. And so last week, we talked about this in Revelation chapter 1, 4 through 7. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, Jesus being the fulfillment of the root of Jesse. He is eternal. And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And we talked about that last week and how Jesus fulfilled all of those things and how every knee will bow. Even those who pierced him will look upon him, those who have sinned against him, not just at the cross, but on everyone who followed, who is living their own lives by their own way, and rather than submitting to God, obeying that gospel and living faithfully before him. So let's get into the subject of wisdom. Because Solomon's going to be given this wisdom from God. And in the New Testament time, we have this great passage here in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 that speaks about the wisdom of God, and it compares it, or really contrasts it, to the wisdom of the world and how the world does not understand it. You see, what we try to do today in the church is often try to blend in with the world. We want to get by in the world without the world really noticing us. We want to hide within our walls. We want to hang out with our brothers and sisters. We want to speak of Bible things and talk about the great kingdom of God as we're all looking forward and hope to being with him one day. And we try to limit our interactions with the world because the world's gone crazy. And the world thinks that we're the crazy ones, that we're the fools. As they look at us and we follow Jesus, who is the embodiment of wisdom of God, that King of Kings being the fulfillment of that wisdom of God, the world ought to see us as fools. That's how they ought to see us. Why is it that we dress up on a Sunday morning and we get ourselves out of bed when we could be sleeping? It's a beautiful day. We're not out at the golf course. Instead, we come and we're sitting here in our pews and we are learning from God. Why do that? That's foolishness to them. Why don't we join in with coarse language and jokes and TV shows and things that this world chases after, and they're all about all of this worthlessness that we've been talking about in the book of Jeremiah chapter 2 in our Sunday morning thread here. Why is it that we don't go after the same things that they do and enjoy life, as they would say it? It seems like foolishness to them. You know, court jesters, way back in medieval times, they would dress, of course, you know, in brightly colored garb, and they would have bells hanging off the tips of their hats, and they would do all kinds of antics, and they were called fools or jesters. But oftentimes, they were the ones who were able to speak wisdom to the king, where others couldn't go to the king and say, "Hey, I think you should do this differently. You should change this. You should make this policy. The people are upset about this." Sometimes the king doesn't want to hear that, and it's off with their heads. But the court jester was in a position where he could go into the king and doing all of his crazy antics that everybody thought him a fool, and yet he could speak directly to the king and tell him what needed to be done. And the king would spare his life because he was a fool. In some ways, that's the position that we as Christians are in this world that we're living in. We try to avoid looking like the fool. We try to dress like, talk like, act like the rest of the world around us. We don't want to be seen as different than our neighbors. Sometimes if we're at work, or our neighbors won't even know that we're Christians. They should know that we're Christians by our love. But sometimes they don't always notice the things that we do and so forth. And so they don't recognize that we're Christians because we try to blend in. We do as much good as our neighbors are doing when they donate clothes and help out at various community groups, garage sales or giveaways, or when there's a disaster in the area, our neighbors that don't go to church are rolling up their sleeves and they're helping somewhere. They're sending donations to whatever cause or whatever, and we're doing the same things. We're trying to blend in with the world around us instead of standing out as fools for the world. And so 1 Corinthians chapter 1 starts out this way: "For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." You see, we who are sitting here know it's the power of God. We understand the power that the cross has and what Jesus accomplished on the cross by willingly going there as the perfect Lamb of God and hanging there so that our sins could be forgiven and His blood shed, forgiving those sins and dying for us in our place. It's our sins. We should have been the one that died, but instead He took our place. He's redeemed us from that. We understand it's the power of God, that nothing else on this earth was able to save us. But that message of the cross to the rest of the world is folly. It's foolishness. And so what do we do with that message of the cross? We hold it back because we don't want to be seen as standing out. We don't want to be seen as a fool, as a jester. And so we do our works quietly, and we hope nobody notices, not so that, you know, it looks like we're bragging or something like that. Jesus says, do your works in secret in the Sermon on the Mount, and that's not what we're talking about. But we're talking about living our life for Christ with the message of the cross upon our lips, and people hearing that message, and those who aren't willing to listen to it, don't want anything to do with it, looking down on us as fools for God, the court jesters of the world, and we need to be okay with that. Because that's the nature of the wisdom of God. We're not about the wisdom of the world. And the two are going to be contrasted here. And Solomon is going to be the type of the wisdom of God that we see fulfilled in Jesus, who is the embodiment of the wisdom of God, the antitype. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 9, it says, His name shall be called Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Is that? I don't know. I feel like I sent them an older version of my lesson here. Okay, no matter. We'll continue on here. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. That's verse 19 here. So here we've got the wisdom of the world pitted against the wisdom of God. And in this matchup, God is doing some trash talk here. And if anybody can do it and really mean it, it's God. Because what He says through the Holy Spirit into Paul's hand as he writes this is, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. Anybody in the world who thinks that they've got wisdom, they got understanding, I'm going to destroy the wisdom of the world, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Just take that message of the cross for a moment. Everyone of the world thought, we are ending this Jesus movement, this self-proclaimed Messiah. We're going to get rid of Him, this threat to our power base. For 30 pieces of silver, get His follower Judas to turn Him in. We're going to come up with all kinds of fake charges, and we're going to condemn Him. We're going to get Pilate, since we don't have any power, the Jewish leaders said, to put anyone to death. We're going to get Pilate to give Him the death sentence. We're even going to select Jesus over Barabbas. And we are going to have a very public execution of this guy, and it's going to send a message that anybody who thinks that they can stand up to us in our wisdom, the Jewish leaders say, we're going to send a message that it's not going to work, that we're the ones who are in control, and it's not this Jewish carpenter who hangs out with fishermen and tax collectors and prostitutes and all the rest of these sinners. We're the ones who've got it all together. And God says, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. The best the world has is nothing before God, though. And that's what we need to understand as Christians who are supposed to be the wisdom of God out in the world, because Jesus was the embodiment of the wisdom of God. So we go to the story here, the end of Solomon's reign, and it's wrapped up in this way. It says, now the rest of the acts of Solomon, known for having God's wisdom. If you mention Solomon out in the world to anybody, they say, oh yeah, he was the wise king. He's all about wisdom. And sure enough, they say that here in 1 Kings 11. And all that he did and his wisdom, are they not written in the book of the Acts of Solomon, a book that we don't have anymore with us? Perhaps there were a lot more stories that came about. But we do have one preserved, and it's here in 1 Kings chapter 3 that I wanted to bring out today. I'm going to give you the ending of the story first. The ending of the story is this in verse 28. And all Israel heard of the judgment that the king had rendered, and they stood in awe of the king because they perceived that the wisdom of God was in him to do justice. You see, when God's people act through the Holy Spirit, through the relationship that we have with God, through our understanding of the Scriptures, when we act in bold ways with God's wisdom, people perceive that and they stand in awe of God that we serve. We don't have the wisdom of the world that we're putting out there. We have the wisdom from God to do justice. Is something not working? I see all these faces at the window up there. Okay. Can you hear me fine? Okay. 1 Kings chapter 3, we can see that as we back up into that story, well, what is this wisdom of God that Solomon was able to perform, to give to the world, and everybody who perceived it could see? And the Holy Spirit saw fit for that to be recorded in the pages of Scripture, so that we would forever have the story of the wisdom of God. And it starts out this way. Then two prostitutes came to the king and stood before him. The one woman said, "Oh my lord, this woman and I live in the same house, and I gave birth to a child while she was in the house. Then on the third day after I gave birth, this woman also gave birth, and we were alone. There was no one else with us in the house, only we two were in the house. And this woman's son died in the night because she lay on him. And she arose at midnight and took my son from beside me while your servant slept, and laid him at her breast, and laid her dead son at my breast. When I rose in the morning to nurse my child, behold, he was dead. But when I looked at him closely in the morning, behold, he was not the child that I had born." You could almost imagine that woman's relief. I mean, those hours of the night while she believed her son dead. She was probably crying and wailing and everything else going on. And this woman who had made the switch in the next room is hearing this. I wonder if she felt any guilt whatsoever of having done that, hoping that she can continue the ruse through the next day, that maybe she could provide some false comfort and say, "Oh, so sorry that your son died," when she's got the living child with her. We don't know the rest of that and how she hoped it to play out. But the other woman said, "No, the living child is mine and the dead child is yours." The first said, "No, the dead child is yours and the living child is mine." Thus they spoke before the king, And there's a lot more there, but each says that the living child is hers, and the king is trying to get the facts and get the information here as to what's going on. And the king said, "Bring me a sword." So a sword was brought before the king. Now, what's the king going to do with this? You could imagine that it took a moment or two, probably, for a sword to be brought in. What were these women thinking? What was going on in their minds? What's he going to do with a sword? Maybe the woman who truly knew that her living son was with this other woman now, she's like really getting concerned. You wonder if Solomon is looking at these women and watching their reactions as they are bringing in this sword before he even pronounces anything. And the wisdom of God is already starting to work here to look and see what's going on with these women and their reactions. The king said, "Divide the living child in two and give half to the other and half to the other." Then the woman whose son was alive said to the king, because her heart yearned for her son, "Oh, my Lord, give her the living child and by no means put him to death." But the other said, "He shall be neither mine nor yours. Divide him." Then the king answered and said, "Give the living child to the first woman and by no means put him to death. She is his mother." That was what everyone had perceived. That they saw that in him was the wisdom of God. Not the wisdom of the world, but the wisdom of God. And why was that? Because Solomon knew, with the wisdom of God, the power of a mother's love. He knew that a mother would rather see her child in the arms of someone else alive than to have her own child killed and divided in two. That mother would sacrifice everything that she was about, everything that she could have, in order for her child to have life. Now, my mother, not only did she have my dad, but she had two hungry boys growing up. And it was just my dad's income, we didn't have a lot. We canned a lot. We hunted a lot. That's kind of how we subsisted. As I grew up, it was always venison, potatoes, and go down to grandma's root cellar and bring up a jar of beans or something, right? Whatever it was, that's how we ate a lot. And I remember time and time again, and I didn't understand this until I was older, that it would come time for dessert and my mother would have made a pie earlier in the week and there were only three pieces left and there were four of us in the house, and suddenly my mother was not hungry. "I don't really want dessert. I think, I'm filled up enough." And there's the mother's love that comes through, that is sacrificial to let dad, my brother, and I have a piece of pie each, and she go without. Time and time again, we can point to things, I'm sure all of us could, the ways in which our mothers sacrificed. That is the wisdom of God. It's rooted in love. And Solomon understood this and knew this. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 26. This is a passage we often talk about as the Proverbs 31 woman, the woman of God, in various ways. And one of the things that she has here is she opens her mouth with wisdom. A woman of God, and all the various characteristics that are listed there in that passage in Proverbs 31, one is she opens her mouth with wisdom. She has the wisdom of God, and a woman of God is described in that particular way. So as we get back to 1 Corinthians 1, where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? God is, again, kind of trash-talking here a little bit. Bring me your best. Bring the best the world has as far as intellect, intelligence, discernment, wisdom. Bring me the best that the world has come up with. bring them here right before me. This sounds very reminiscent of Job almost, and the way that God reaches out and asks for, where are the ones who would come and debate with me and speak with me? And they have nothing to offer because the wisdom of God is being pitted against the wisdom of the world, the wisdom of man. Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. What's the folly of what we preach? It's the message of the cross that we just saw in verse 18. The message of the cross is foolishness to those who don't believe, who are perishing, it says there. And so God took the very thing that seems foolish to the world, the thing of court jesters in the world, and he said, I am giving you this message that the world is just going to scoff at, scratch their head at. What do you mean that through God's Son, through weakness, through him offering himself willingly on a cross, that somehow is going to take away your sin? And that is the only hope offered to mankind? What is it that you Christians are following? It is the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. It's not going to save everybody in the world. We know that the road is wide that leads to destruction, and many are on it. We know that the road is narrow and few find it that leads to eternal life. And so we are God's fools going forth with the message of the cross that's folly, that we're proclaiming or preaching to the world all this foolishness in their eyes. The cross sounds like nonsense. And Job, as I mentioned, seems like, you know, his friends, quote friends, were coming to him with all of the wisdom of the world. Job is sitting there having lost everything but his wife, who was not a help to him but a hindrance to him in his spiritual walk with God, coming down on him, and even his own person is afflicted, and he's sitting there in ashes scraping sores on his body with shards of pottery. And his friends sit for a long time in silence, which was good, but then they begin to speak up, and we see that all three of these friends are not really great friends at all. They're coming to him with all of the wisdom of the world, and he calls them out on this. He says here in Job 12, verse 2, no doubt you are the people. In other words, no doubt you are the highest of the high that people can possibly come up with in the wisdom of the world. No doubt you are the people, and wisdom will die with you. Job 13, verse 5, oh, that you would keep silent, and it would be your wisdom. The best thing that the world can do, and the wisdom that it has, is to remain silent and listen to God's. And Job, of course, stays faithful and comes around to God's wisdom by the end. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. Over and over and over again, when I used to go to the Camp Hunt men's retreats up near Utica, New York, on the third weekend of September, and it was always cold up there in the mountains, and the third weekend of September. You sometimes had to wear your winter coat and everything else. They'd have fires going in the wood stove and all that. You couldn't sleep in the cabins that had no heat. You didn't dare close the windows up because that would just keep the snores in a little bit more of those guys that were all at the retreat. But over and over again, when they'd fill out the papers for this, and they'd say suggestions for next year's retreat. And I'd always put this verse here, verse 23. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. I thought that would make a great retreat theme, because we preach Christ crucified in the face of all of the world and the foolishness that they think that we're all about. That we, as a people of God, need to get ourselves up and out of our church buildings with the message of foolishness, because that's how it's going to be perceived by most as they hear us speak of this Jesus who denied himself, literally took up his cross, and obeyed God rather than himself. There's so many things that you can do with a theme centered around this. We preach crucified. It's a stumbling block to Jews. Why was it that word there that's used is scandalon in the Greek? And that means, in English, scandal. It's a scandal to the Jews who were awaiting a Messiah from the beginning of time, especially from when Moses gave the law and all the prophets began to prophesy and they began to hear of this Messiah that would come. It's a scandal that Jesus claimed to be God's son and that somehow people crucified him. He died a death like any common criminal would die. How could that possibly happen? How could they hold their head up high and say, yeah, that's our Messiah there on the cross? It's a scandal to them. It's a stumbling block to them. And to Gentiles, those who are outside of the covenant with God, it's folly. It's foolishness. Don't understand it whatsoever. And so, as we go to 1 Kings chapter 3, the very beginning here of Solomon's reign, Solomon has just gone through quite a bit to be able to secure his kingdom. One of David's last dying words to his son Solomon was, there's some unfinished business here. That if you truly are going to take the throne and hold the throne, you're going to have to take care of some things. First of all, Solomon's brother Adonijah had already given a rebellion against David, trying to take the throne by force, and David thwarted that by making Solomon king. But he says Adonijah needs some dealing with here. Well, Adonijah, we know, goes into Bathsheba, Solomon's mother, and wants to have Abishag, the young lady that would keep David warm because he couldn't stay warm any longer. And so Solomon says, well, what more can he ask for than the throne? And so he puts his brother Adonijah to death. Well, Joab, the commander of the army that had given, and David's cousin, who had given so much grief to David throughout his entire command, he sided with Adonijah. And so Joab needed to be dealt with as well, and David told Solomon such before he died. And so Solomon had to take care of Joab, and Benaniah takes care of him. But then there was Shimei. And when Absalom, one of David's sons, had rebelled against David, Shimei was standing as David and his people were leaving Jerusalem, and he's up on the hill calling out curse after curse after curse. And Joab at that time wanted to go kill Shimei, but David says, well, what if God told him to curse? Who am I? You know, if my own son is rebelling against me, then who's this Shimei that I should care about this? But he also told Solomon, don't let Shimei's head go down to the grave as gray. Let's go ahead and take care of him as well. And Solomon told Shimei he could live as long as he stayed in a certain place, and he decided he was going to get up and leave. And so Solomon called him out on it, put Shimei to death as well. And so all of this happens on the eve of what happens here in 1 Kings 3. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, ask what I shall give you. And Solomon said, you have shown great steadfast love to your servant David, my father, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart towards you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love. He's referring back to the covenant that we just read. in 2 Samuel chapter 7, that his throne would forever have someone upon it. It would be established forever. And it would be through David's line that the root of Jesse would be fulfilled in Jesus. Solomon brings this out, and he realizes this incredible legacy that he's been handed. And it says that Solomon at this time was walking in the ways of his father David. And so Solomon is trying to do what he can do to live up to David, who has this name made for him. And he knows how he and David, that David had that God and David had a relationship, that David was after God's heart. And so Solomon has a lot to live up to. And so he says, I know that my father David walked before you, and that you loved him, and that you've given me this kingdom of my father. You've given him a son to sit on his throne this day. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of David my father. Although I am but a little child, I do not know how to go out or come in. Well, we know that Solomon was not a little child. He was a grown man. But he's talking about in the ways of the world, that he doesn't have the wisdom of the world that a king usually has when he comes into power. I don't have wisdom. I don't have what most kings have. He sees himself through different eyes. I do not know how to go out or come in, and your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too many to be numbered or counted for multitude. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, that I may discern between good and evil, for who is able to govern this your great people? It took some wisdom to even ask for that, didn't it? That instead of asking for long life or riches or that he would conquer all of his enemies, that's the kind of things that kings of the world would ask for, and that would be the wisdom of the world at its highest. Hey, I want to live for, you know, the next 50 years, and I want to go ahead and be in charge of, you know, the whole country, and everybody's going to listen to me, and all this. But that would have been the wrong thing to ask for. It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. And God said to him, because you have asked this, because you've not asked for yourself long life or riches or the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, behold, I now do according to your word. Behold, I give you a wise and discerning mind, so that none like you has been before you, and none like you shall arise after you. I give you also what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that no other king shall compare with you all your days. So not only because he asked for discernment, putting the power and control in God's hands, where it's always been, but just saying, help me to manage the gifts that you have given me well. God says, I will do this. There's going to be none like you. And I'll also give you those other things that kings who have worldly wisdom would probably ask for. But to those who are called, both Greeks... Okay, this is back to 1 Corinthians 1. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. So Jesus is the embodiment of not only the power of God, but also the wisdom of God, because he's the one who went to the cross and did that. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. Jesus embodied this wisdom. We can see in John 7 when the temple priest sent out their guard to go arrest Jesus. They came back empty-handed. Some of them wanted to arrest him, but no one laid hands on him. The officers then came to the chief priests and Pharisees, who said to them, why did you not bring him? The officers answered, no one ever spoke like this man. Here's the wisdom of God being taught, and even those who are in authority to grab hold of him are pushed back, thwarted by God's wisdom. So in Galatians chapter 3, 26 and 27, we know we put on Christ to the world when we are baptized into Christ. And so here's what we are to do as Christ followers. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. We're going to be fools out in the world who rejects us. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting, for the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. God grants us his wisdom to benefit us and his kingdom here on earth. Are we asking for it so that we can certainly go forth with it in our lives? I'll leave you with this question. Do you have God's wisdom to help you in life and lead others to eternal life? Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for the wisdom of God that you make available to us. We are to go forth with that wisdom to preach Christ crucified to a world that sees it as folly or a stumbling block, a scandal. And yet, this is what we do. As your Son Jesus embodied that wisdom and willingly went to the cross, we are to take that message of the cross and go forth with the wisdom of God so that others who want to be saved, who see this as the only hope of mankind and not folly or foolishness, will want to hear more, want to obey that gospel, and want to have the hope of eternal life in your Son Jesus. It's through him we pray. Amen.
Order my steps in your word.